So we learned about molarity already, and we're going to see that there's a whole lot of other concentration units out there. Molarity is a unit we will use by far and away the most often, so let's go ahead and get that concentration unit up on the screen. Molarity we will use the most. And throughout our class right now, molarity is the one we'll focus on when we do problems that need a concentration unit. But we do need to learn about several other concentration units as well, because throughout your general chemistry life, you're going to run into the need for other concentration units, how to utilize them, how to convert between concentration units. So we have molarity. We know it's moles of solute on the top and liters of solution in the bottom. We know that this is a way of defining its concentration, which concentration by definition is how much are you getting into that solution. So it is going to be important for you to not just have moles per liter, as we're going to see. Moles of what? In this case, solute. Liters of what? In this case, we see its solution. So let's move on to our next concentration unit that we need to know about. It's called molality, and molality sounds a whole lot like molarity, doesn't it? Molality is abbreviated with a lowercase m instead of the capital M that we saw with molarity, and here is how it is defined. In the numerator, it is, again, moles of solute, so that part's the same. But the denominator is very different. It's different in two aspects. Instead of liters, we're dealing with kilograms. See that? Mass. Instead of solution, this is the only one in which the denominator is defined by how much solvent is in there. And if there's anything that students forget, it's that piece of information. The denominator is not kilograms of solution, it's kilograms of solvent. So underline solvent, put a star by it, say, I promise not to forget that it's solvent in the denominator. Okay? So let's do some work with that. And that was just re-emphasis of what I just said. All right, so if we're going to calculate the molality, we have to first notice that it says molality and not molarity. We would always start with the equation. So we know the numerator is moles, and we're going to be specific, moles of solute. That's the thing being dissolved. In this case, it's sodium chloride. Divided by kilograms of solution. I mean, I just said it, didn't I? Kilograms of solvent. And in this case, and in almost all cases, but certainly not all cases, our solvent is water. Assume water is your solvent unless you're told otherwise. Okay, so those are the things that we need. So to get the moles of solute, we'll start up here by taking the solute, which we have 5 grams of that sodium chloride. And we realize we don't want grams of sodium chloride, so we'll cancel that out and move it to moles of sodium chloride. Now, where do we go to get that number? We go to the periodic table. We look up the sodium, which is 22.99, and we look up the chlorine, which is 35.45, and we add those together, and we get 58.44. We put that with the grams and the one with the moles, and that will give me the moles of sodium chloride. That's the numerator. Whoops, grams, canceling, moles are left. I got my numerator. My denominator is kilograms of solvent. Now you'll get to where, if you haven't already, and this is grams of water, you are going to be able to simply move your decimal place over 3 places to get to kilograms. But we have this relationship that gets us to kilograms. Divide by 1,000, that's moving it over 3 places. So now we have our values here. The numerator became 0.856, and that was moles of solute. The denominator became 0.350, and that's kilograms of water. And that will give me a value for the molality that we are trying to obtain of 2.44. And we can write it a couple ways. We can write it as moles per kilogram. Okay, that's one way. Or we could say it's 0.244 and put a little M after it. Okay, so 2.44, and what we will say is molal. It is a 2.44 molal solution, and there is the molality calculation for this solution. Okay, so let's go to the next concentration unit that we're interested in here, and this is percent by mass. Now, we have seen percent by mass before when we were talking about determining the percent of an element in a compound, and that was a percent by mass. But in this case, it's a percent by mass of a solution. Now, a percent is always the part over the whole times 100. So you're just interested in what is the part, what is the whole, times 100, and that gives you a percent. So in this case, when we're talking about solutions, the part will be the solute, the thing being dissolved. That'll be in the numerator. The whole, by definition, the whole is the whole solution, everything. So the denominator will be the grams, or the mass of the solution. Now it says here just mass. I will typically run with grams and grams, but the reality is you can use any mass unit you want. You could use kilograms of both. You could use pounds of both, and you will always get the same answer. So it really doesn't matter, so that's why it says mass and mass for this problem. All right, now, if you're reading a problem and it tells you about the solution and it says, hey, this solution is, for example, a 5.5% sodium chloride solution, I want you to be able to take that percent and I want you to be able to convert it into a dimensional analysis unit factor, a converter, the thing that will help us go between one unit and another unit like we did here, right? That is a dimensional analysis conversion factor. It helps us convert between grams and moles. A percent can always be written as a conversion factor, and when I read a percent, I will always write it out. So I think to myself, okay, it's 5.5, what's the part? The part is the sodium chloride. What is the whole? It's the solution. And by definition, percent means out of 100. That's why we do the multiplying by 100. It'll give us that fraction as if it were out of 100. So whenever I see a percent given to me, I will rewrite it like this, okay? It means I have 5.5 grams of sodium chloride in every 100 grams of solution, so I could write this conversion factor. So if I'm reading along and I need to use a percent value that's given to me in the problem, before I ever start working the problem, I will take that percent and I will write it like this. So I translate what I see here as the how much it is out of 100, which is what a percent is. So let's look at a problem. Oh, I got some red exclamation points. That means don't forget that. Okay, so here is a problem in which I want to do a couple problems here. What is the percent by mass of sodium chloride if 5.6 grams of sodium chloride are dissolved in 44.4 grams of water? I give this as an example because it's a really common mistake that students make. We know we want percent by mass. So percent by mass will be the grams of the sodium chloride, that's the solute, over the grams of solution, I remember that, times 100. The grams of sodium chloride are given to me, and it's 5.6 grams. The grams of solution is not given to me, and so very often somebody would read that and put a 44.4 right there. Why should you not? Well, we don't put grams of water, we put grams of solution. So 44.4 grams of water plus the 5.6 grams of sodium chloride is what is going to give me the grams of solution. And then I'll take that times the 100%. And that will give me the percent by mass of sodium chloride in water. And the value is, to two significant figures, which is all I can really know it, 11%. So what does 11% mean? It means that if I had 100 grams of solution, 11 of those grams would be sodium chloride. So that's how that translates once it's calculated, but this is how you would calculate it. Okay, so now we're going to do a problem where we're given a percent and we're asked to utilize that percent. So like I told you, when I see a percent given to me, I don't go very far before I write out what that percent means. I see that it's a percent by mass about a solution. So I know the 4.5 pertained to the grams, and I choose a mass unit, of sodium chloride. That's the part, and the whole, because it's a percent, is 100, and it's grams of solution. So I write that down and I keep in my mind that I have developed a tool that will convert me between those two. So if ever I was given one and needed the other, this would be my converter. And then I start reading some further. I see that they gave me the grams of solution. So that is the other given for me. Now I typically, when I'm working problems as a review of this, don't want to start with the converter because I don't know whether I need it this way or upside down. So I look at this and it's 65.0 grams of something. That doesn't help me if I don't know what that something is. And it's grams of, and I'm real specific, solution. Okay? So now I know that this is what was given to me. I see that I'm trying to figure out the grams of sodium chloride in that solution, and I know that this is my converter between them. So I can go from grams of, I think I have a little eraser here. I'm going to give it a try. It sort of works. There we go. I go from grams of solution that I don't want to grams of sodium chloride that they have given to me or that they want me to get to, and I'm going to use my converter. The 4.5 goes with the grams of sodium chloride and the 100 goes with the grams of solution. So at this point I now will know the grams of sodium chloride and the value for that number is 2.9. Now you shouldn't leave that problem without thinking about the reasonableness of that number. It is 4.5% sodium chloride, okay? Less than 10%, less than 5%. It's a small amount. If it were 10%, I would expect 6.5 grams. This is less than 10%. It's reasonable that it's less than 6.5. It's a little less than half of that. So think about the reasonableness of your number. It makes sense to me that that would be true. If I got something bigger than 65, that'd be a problem, wouldn't it? Okay. You could have a percent by volume as well, okay? So if it says in a problem that it's a percent by volume, replace the grams with a volume unit, maybe milliliters, maybe liters. Any volume unit would be fine. Typically, we work with milliliters in chemistry. So a percent by volume is an exact same analysis, and it's analogous to what we just did here. There is a world, and every once in a while, you might see a percent mass volume, okay? It's percent mass volume. It is typically grams of solute over milliliters of solution. So every once in a while you might see that given to you in a problem. You just need to be very looking for what's it percent of? Is it percent by mass? Is it percent by volume? Is it a percent mass volume? Whatever it is, make sure you're pulling out the appropriate units for that. All right? So you just work all the problems. Similarly, I'm not going to do a whole set of percent by volume problems. They're exactly the same thing, except you will be dealing with milliliters instead of grams. Now, sometimes the concentration is super low, and you don't want to say something like, you know, this solution is a 0.000000% sodium chloride solution. There's just way too many zeros, and we want to be able to put that into numbers that are better. All right. So we, when we're dealing with really low concentrations, might have a part per million, and we might have a part per billion. Let me back up. Percent. Part per hundred. Cent. There's 100 pennies in a dollar, okay? Part per cent, part per hundred is per cent for that reason. Part per million, part per billion. So instead of multiplying by 100 in our per cent, we're multiplying by a million and a billion respectively in those. And if I were giving a part per million or a part per billion, I could create a fraction like this, this dimensional analysis term, based upon a million or based upon a billion. So work to calculate a part per million and part per billion is just like a percent, but instead of multiplying by 100, you're going to multiply by a million or a billion respectively. But let's see a problem that we have where we're given a part per, in this case, billion, and we want to determine something from that. So in a similar way that I took a percent and created this dimensional analysis term, I can take a part per billion, and this is 12 part per billion, and I am able to take that And I am able to turn it into a dimensional analysis term. So it is 12, and you're going to use mass, okay, a mass ratio. Grams of, in this case, it's lead because it says it's this many parts per billion of lead in a water sample. And the denominator is no longer going to be 100 because this is not a percent. This is a part per billion. So we have down here 10 to the ninth grams of the water sample. Okay, so that's the solution. We don't really, I mean, that's really a low amount. So if you're drinking water, you're not saying, I'm drinking a solution. It is a water sample that has a little bit of lead in it. Okay, so that is the parts per billion. Now, we're going to take this piece of information and utilize it in our calculation. So in this problem, it says how many lead atoms are in a 1 gram sample of water. So my starting point is going to be that I have a 1 gram, and I'm going to call it WS for water sample. Okay, I have a 1 gram water sample. I want to know about the lead. Here's my converter. I don't want grams of water sample. I want grams of lead, because if I knew how many grams of lead I had, I could eventually get how many atoms that was. All right, so I'm ready to put my numbers in. There's 12 grams of lead in every billion grams of water. So it would take a billion grams of water to give me 12 grams of lead. Now, I'm going to get, that gets me from grams of the water sample to grams of lead, which I want to know about lead. But what do I want to know about lead? How many atoms it is. So I know I can go from grams of lead to moles of lead. That's a number. Okay. I go to the periodic table, and it's 207 point something. Let's see. 207.2 grams of lead in a mole of lead. So I'm in the number world, but it actually asks for the specific number of atoms. So I'm going to assume I want to go from moles of lead. I have no idea what I'm doing there. Mob. Let's try again. Moles of lead per atoms of lead. And a mole is 6.022 times 10. To the 23rd. So it takes a lot of atoms. So if I were to stop here, I can imagine I'm taking these numbers. That's a very, 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 very tiny amount of lead in a gram of water. Because it's only 12 grams in a billion grams of water, and I only have 1 gram of it. So it's a really tiny gram. And I divide by this. This is a very tiny mole. But it's a lot of atoms still. So when I do all this calculation here, the value for the atoms of lead is 3.4 times 10 to the 13. That's a whole lot of atoms. If we were to try to count that high, we couldn't count that high. But it is still a very, very tiny amount of lead in that 1 gram sample. All right, so that is how you would utilize, given a part per billion, in a similar way, it'd be part per million, but we'd replace that 9 with a 6, and we can work problems based upon that. Okay, so what have we done so far? Let's kind of just review. We're working through concentration units, okay? We were given we knew how to do molarity coming into this lesson. Now we know about molality, and then percent, part per million, and part per billion. Not the only concentration units we're going to see, but let's stop there for now.